Hello, and welcome to the Washington Week Webcast Extra. No uneven parallel bars here, no dressage, no badminton, just good old-fashioned news left over from the main broadcast. I'm joined by Susan Davis of USA Today, Karen Tumulty of The Washington Post, Amy Walter of ABC News, and David Wessel of The Wall Street Journal. Just because we're not in London doesn't mean there are not games being played. In Washington, you like that? In Washington, the games are of a different sort. Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid chose the high wire.
The word's out that he hasn't paid any taxes for 10 years. Let him prove that he has paid taxes, because he hasn't.
He, of course, was talking about Republican nominee Mitt Romney. And here was Romney's response.
Harry Reid really has to put up or shut up, all right? Now, let me also say categorically, I have paid taxes every year, and a lot of taxes, a lot of taxes. So Harry is simply wrong.
Put up or shut up, that's strong language coming from Governor Romney. And not only that, but he came out and he gave a news conference today after an event, something he doesn't often do.
Right.
And he clearly came out with his punching gloves
on.
Remember
how today was supposed to be about the jobs number? He was supposed to make it, this was supposed to be the case that he makes another bad report and unemployment is up. Instead, he's getting in a fight with Harry Reid, who set the most predictable trap ever.
Yeah.
Right? To make up, to just say something and let Mitt Romney walk right into it. All Mitt Romney had to say was, I have no idea what he's talking about. Next question.
Except that Harry Reid was getting beat up so universally for having thrown out this unsubstantiated
yes.
rumor as fact on the Senate floor and off the Senate floor that I think that you could understand why the Romney people would think they were kind of safe in pushing back.
Right, but
except
when you say put up or shut up, when you say put up or shut up, then the automatic response, which we're already seeing, I'm sure you guys all saw in your email boxes from Democrats, was, that's right, why don't you just put out your tax returns?
It's worth noting, too, that Harry Reid's career before he went into politics was as an amateur boxer.
Amateur. Amateur being the operative term. Let's go back up on Capitol Hill, Sue, because I want to talk to you about another interesting, we're always looking for these little signs. And mm-hmm. the sign this week that Congress is not what it used to be was the retirement of Steve
right.
LaTourette. Tell us about him and what why it's significant that he's deciding not to run for office again.
Steve LaTourette is an interesting character because he's what would be considered now maybe a moderate or a centrist, but he was also a member of the 1994 Republican wave, the revolutionary class that came in. And his candor this week, I would almost liken it to Olympia Snowe when she announced her retirement from the Senate. And they really just blamed partisanship, that they were just tired. And they were tired. And he specifically blamed the highway bill, that this was something that bridges and roads, this is something that Congress should be able to do, and we can't even do this anymore, and I'm tired of it, and I'm leaving.
When these moderates leave Capitol Hill, is there, I mean, they come out, mm-hmm. Olympia Snowe did it in the Senate, and they say this place is not the same anymore, and I'm leaving. Does it leave a ripple even? Does it make a ripple?
It's hard to say. I mean, in the immediate term, no, I don't think it does, because I often think a lot of times when they're leaving, they're often replaced by someone that is actually more to the right or more to the left than the moderate that they're replacing. Steve LaTourette, though, did have one of the best lines of the week where he likened Congress to an alcoholic and said it won't change until it hits rock bottom.
That's good. That's,
can you get more rock bottom than 7% approval rating?
They're going to try, I think.
Right. I think the problem is they're losing the people who can actually get things done.
That's right.
It's easy to be one of the debaters, but there are very few people who can seem to bring the Congress together to pass legislation. And as more and more of them leave, it leads people to just despair.
Well, that leads me to talking a little bit more about your book, David, because in your book, you don't quite despair, but you do in a very interesting way just lay out what the choices are here in Washington and why things are where they are, specifically in this argument about the debt, which everybody says they care deeply, deeply about, and yet we are at this place where there's no more conversation going on.
Yeah, it's very frustrating, and one of the reasons I did the book was that there's such a blurring of fact and opinion that you can't tell what's truth and what's just someone's political persuasion. I spent some time with Leon Panetta, who's now the defense secretary. He was the White House budget director under Bill Clinton. He was in the chairman of the House Budget Committee when there was a compromise in the H.W. Bush administration. And he said something to me that really stuck with me and left me a little bit in despair. He said, I used to tell students when he was teaching in California that if we don't have leadership, then we have a crisis. But leadership has failed, we've had the crisis, and we're still not getting any action, so there goes my theory. So I think what's hard to figure out is what changes this. It's either going to, there's really only two possibilities. One is that the financial markets finally rebel, that things get better in the rest of the world, and it's not possible for the United States to borrow unlimited amounts of of money at very low interest rates, or there is some outbreak of leadership. I think very few people wanted Ross Perot to be president, but he did play a very constructive role in that race by kind of forcing the candidates to deal with what was going on.
I do think actually some of the wackiest candidates can force other people to have conversations they wouldn't otherwise have.
Ron Paul
even if
did
they
that.
Themselves are never going to be elected. Ron Paul, so not that he's wacky, don't write, please. Karen, I want to ask you about another interesting thing that played out this week, which is the politics of chicken sandwiches. I want to know how Chick-fil-A got to be the latest flashpoint in our national culture debate.
Well, I think it's basically the founder of Chick-fil-A said publicly that he cited his religious belief as the reason for being against gay marriage, and this ignited a firestorm of protest against the chain. Now, I think it's much a reflection of our media culture, the fact that, you know, a movement can be born in 5 minutes on Twitter that sparked this. Because let's face it, I mean, owners of corporations have long had strong views, and these are based, he says, in his religious beliefs. But it has sparked an entire protest against the chain.
And a counter-protest with a lot of Republicans going to the restaurants.
Am I right in saying, however, this seems like another example of, you know, our silo politics, mm-hmm. where the people screaming the loudest were the people on the farthest end of the spectrum, the pro-gay marriage activists having a kiss-in today on one side, and the anti-gay marriage folks seizing this as an opportunity to have this argument, while most people in the middle just wanted lunch.
Exactly. I mean, the fact is that there are a lot of people who, for instance, you know, Domino's Pizza, the owner of Domino's Pizza has long been a major funder of the anti-abortion movement. I just don't think...
And Jeff Bezos at Amazon is funding a gay, pro-gay marriage mm-hmm. referendum in Washington State.
And I actually, you know, think that it's a little bit disturbing if, you know, basically, you know, commerce is you know,
health
drawn around, yeah, to
you're
people's...
old enough to have had to boycott grapes. Remember, right. this goes back a while. But it seems to be more vitriolic, and you're right about the social media. I have to, before we go, ask you all a question. You know what we've really been doing? Honest to goodness, we're normal people. We've been watching the Olympics, too. So I'm curious about, for each of you, what was the most intriguing or memorable... And I'm going to claim Gabby, so you can't say that. I'm claiming Gabby Douglas because she's fabulous. I love her. But, Amy, other than Gabrielle Douglas, who's amazing, inspiring.
You know, I love the athletes that do the sports that you know nothing about, who get no endorsement deals and yet make incredible records. A woman who's and I don't remember her name, but the skeet shooter.
Skeet right. shooter.
Yes. Right. She's won more medals consecutively than any Olympic athlete in history, and she seems like the nicest person ever. And so I give her credit because every day she's out there shooting at skeet, she's never going to be on the cover of Men's Fitness or whatever else, Sports Illustrated.
Or
Women's Fitness.
It could happen. Karen?
Well, there are a lot of inspiring stories, but for me, there have also been a lot of these moments of turning on my television saying, this is an Olympic sport. the trampoline, I mean, I found it mesmerizing to watch, but I didn't know dressage was an Olympic sport until a few months ago. So.
And it took Ann Romney for most of us to know about it.
You know, I agree with those. I love watching the gymnastics and the synchronized diving. I can't imagine who thought this up, but I realized how old I was when I really loved the shots of the parents in the stands. And I realized I have a lot more in common with them than any of these guys who were doing the swimming.
You also realize the hundreds of thousands of dollars of investment they had made mm-hmm. in their children.
Absolutely.
In all these years. It's amazing that they have get this far. So.
I mean, I fell asleep last night watching Chinese ping pong, or ping pong, and it was China versus China, and I was fully invested in it. So.
But you fell asleep.
But China won.
I know. They got the gold.
But I mean, it may be easy, but I think Michael Phelps is just phenomenal. And even sputtering in the beginning, but still going on to set these records and the medals he's won, and just sort of this example of the incredible capability of the human body is just sort of amazing.
I don't know about you, but it didn't bother me in the least to know what the outcomes were before I would go home and watch it, because just the process of watching these athletes at their best doing this amazing stuff that I can't even imagine like climbing up on the bar, let alone holding myself on it by one hand. I can't imagine any of that. Watching them do it, it's all about excellence.
I like knowing the end. I'm somebody who peeks at the end of books.
I don't go that far, but I do like knowing the end. Thank you, everybody. While you're online, check out our essential reads, what all of our panelists are reading and writing, and also my take this week on what economic segregation is doing to our politics. And we'll see you on the next Washington Week Webcast Extra.